One of the things that we don't do on Handmade Hero, and the reason we don't do it is because I don't know anything about it, is compression. And compression is one of those things that is behind the scenes in basically every game that exists. In fact, it's behind the scenes in pretty much anything that exists, because fundamentally speaking, you're always trying to get a little bit more out of a little bit less. And so any game that ships today has a ton of compression in the back end. Whatever the assets are stored in is typically has nothing to do with how they might appear raw when the artists created them. And so what I wanted to do with this first session is kind of invite people who are the absolute like experts in compression, the people that I ask when I'm like, I don't know what to do with this or how this sort of thing works, please explain it to me. So I asked the folks at Rad Game Tools to come and give us like sort of how they think about compression. If you're someone who's interested in sort of learning more about compression, how do you frame it, how do you think about it. And so today it's a real pleasure for me to have Jeff Roberts and Fabian Giesen with me from Rad Game Tools. I'm going to sort of prompt them, but I'm going to let them talk as much as possible because I am a compression noob if ever there was one. So first of all, before we get started, could you guys maybe give me a little bit of background? Jeff, you started Rad Game Tools a long time ago. How did you get into compression? What brought you to this as a technology focus?
I guess, Rad's been doing this for nearly 30 years, and we started, the first thing I ever wrote was an EXE compressor, which I believe is one of the first compression things. Didn't you work on Crunchy too? But you worked on an EXE compressor.
That was after I'd done a lot of compression, though.
So. Yeah, the first thing Rad ever sold was something called PackEXE that just compressed an EXE as you ran it. It decoded into memory and ran. So
this was for executables, like on floppy disks?
Exactly. So they'd, and like UPX is what people use nowadays, but it is just a... when you run an executable, there's a tiny little, you can set it up so a tiny little program runs that expands the big program in memory, and then you jump into it, and it's as if you ran the original program, but it's just decoding on the fly.
So you sort of have this it's almost like a bootloader or something, where you have a tiny program that's designed to do nothing but decompress the real program.
Right. And so the constraints there are kind of interesting in the sense that you can't be a big program because it's not a program that it is installed on the computer all the time. It's part of the executable itself. So it's a reasonably pure form of compression in the sense that it's all packed into one thing. You know, there's the joke of like, anybody can make a compressor if you know the data that you're compressing, because you just put the data that you're compressing in the thing and you're like, oh, hey, it's magic. It was one byte.
Do you even need the one byte?
Well, to say whether it was that one or that.
If you only need to compress that one file, you don't need even that one
byte. Right,
if you ever want to be able to at least, like, for appearances, take a second file and not compress it, you need to have at least a bit saying whether this is the compressed file or not.
It sounds like an excellent executable compressor.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, that is kind of the joke of there is certainly part of compression attracts kind of the zero-point energy loonies. And there's
oh, really?
Definitely.
Okay.
There's a big crossover in, like...
I'm sorry, zero-point energy, I think the only thing that I know this from is from watching the movie The Incredibles. Is that... he has, like, a little thing that he can move people around.
It's the right term, right? It's for the people who imagine there's just energy floating around.
I think a better analogy is... because it's pretty much the same people. It's just perpetual motion machines.
Yeah.
People are really into that.
UFOs, all that stuff.
So they just want to... Or they feel like they could get, like, infinite compression or something like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
And recursive compression isn't something that they use as a way to make it sound... Like, oh, you run it, and then you run it again.
And
by the way this doesn't work is also for the exact same reason. Like, this is fundamentally about thermodynamics.
Okay.
Like, it really pretty much is. I mean, normally do it is mathematically. You can't just do it by counting.
Okay.
Like, if you say I can compress any file.
Yes.
Like, there's just, like, the number of files of, say, length up to 100 bytes is limited. Like, you can count them all.
Yes.
And you can enumerate them. And if you can say, I can compress all of them, what you're really saying is, like, I can take that set that has a certain size, map that to a smaller set because they're all smaller.
Right.
And, like, somehow not lose anything, and that just can't be invertible. Like, yes. That's the entirety of the argument.
Okay.
Which, like, there's some thought there, but this is not fancy mathematics.
Okay.
And the kind of people you're arguing with in that community will not accept that argument.
Right.
Okay.
I have this program that does this. Like, yes, and I can prove without even looking at the program that it can't possibly work.
So this is kind of interesting, because it's like, I did not realize that this sort of thing was a discussion that happened.
Yeah, yeah.
I imagine that because compression...
It still happens.
It still happens, yeah. Even today. Okay.
Yeah.
So there's no way
So the only point of all that was that the way that you kind of prevent that data leakage, because like you can imagine here a program that compressed a file by taking the first byte of the file and sticking it on the end of the file name, right?
Right, right.
And then the file name gets longer and longer. It's like, what is 0 bytes? The file's tiny, but so part of like measuring a compressor to make sure you're not cheating is you add in the size of the file that, I mean, the executable itself, not the file name,
but the
whole thing matters. So exe compression was nice in that sense of like, it's all part of one.
I see what you're saying. So you're basically, when you said it's a pure form of compression, kind of what you mean is there's no hand waving here, because anything that you added that was a cheat in the executable is counted in the size automatically, since that executable is the thing you're shipping.
Right.
Whereas I suppose if it was an image or something, you could just make the compressor bigger and bigger and bigger, and
there's all kinds of tricks you can pull. So like if you do this theoretically, it looks in theory, like there's this whole notion of a channel, which is the medium you're communicating over, like might be a file you're writing stuff into.
Okay.
And like if you're doing compression honestly, you have to worry about what exactly constitutes your channel, because otherwise you can cheat.
Okay.
Like if you say, oh, for example, like if you're on Windows on NTFS, files can have multiple streams. And like if you do a directory listing, it'll show you the size of the first stream.
I see.
So one way to do a compressor is to just take the data from the first stream, move it over to the second stream, and like now, like if you do a directory listing, it doesn't show up. But the data, you laugh, but like this kind of stuff happens inadvertently all the time. Like you can do compression if you have a medium that gives you extra capacity that counts as part of the channel elsewhere. So for example, if you're sending UDP packets over the network, these have the actual data bytes you're sending, but the length of the packet is part of the thing.
Right.
And you get that length
data
back, and that's useful data.
Yeah.
So like one thing you can do if you're sending, that's an actual thing that people do, and that totally makes sense. If you're doing, say, compression for a game, and you're sending regular packets, you can try to arrange things so that the last number of bytes of the packet are usually zeros. And then you just say implicitly, like, if the decompressor keeps reading after the packet is over, you just feed it zeros.
I see.
So then you can, because the size is part of the thing that gets sent over the network, you can get some data for free.
Right, which you would not really be able to use that size for anything else, so you're sort of just pushing a little bit of extra information in there, which is always...
Exactly. And it's not like it's huge, you get a couple bits from there, but like, you have to be careful to honestly define what your channel is, and like, these things like file size or file name and so on, there's extra metadata, access permissions, extra streams. You can hide data there if you want to.
Okay.
And you just gotta be careful if somebody tells you they have the magic machine that makes these files smaller. You have to be really careful what they're doing.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm very interested that came up so quickly, that it was kind of like the first thing on people's mind.
If you've ever discussed with anybody about data compression, this comes up immediately.
Okay.
Like, you will find somebody who has, like, same with physics, like there's people with their perpetual motion plans, and like they want to talk to you about it.
Someday it's going to work, man. It's just going to keep going and going like the Energizer Bunny.
Yeah.
Just to get just a little bit more background, so that was all great, but I just want, so people who don't know you. So you wrote an exe compressor as the first thing you
sold. Yeah, that's the first thing that we ever, and we were kind of a hardware and software company then, and so that was the first piece of software we ever sold.
Okay.
And we sold it to another company who, can't remember what they were. But anyway, I started on it early, I find. Compression is, especially data compression as opposed to image and the other stuff, is a fairly, it's less this way now, and we can talk about that, pure in the sense that you run it and you get a smaller file or you don't. So that was always appealing to me. It's a fun thing to like, it is a thing you can get sucked into, and this is even when I was talking to Checker, who added compression to his game recently.
Checker is Chris Hecker.
Yeah, yeah, who like can get sucked into these things of it's just a fun iterative process. And so certainly...
And I guess you have kind of a clean number that's like, is my program getting better or worse?
Yeah, yeah.
As opposed to like architecture stuff where you're like, did it get better or worse? I don't know.
And then now recently not recently, but this has always been true, but it's never been true more than now, is there is this extra axis that exists, which is what is the speed trade-off you're willing to do for the amount of compression?
Right, which I guess RAD is
which
specifically
is where we
concerned
live.
With because
yeah,
of
RAD
the
kinda lives
game
in that
nature.
Space. Yeah. So anyway, that's
okay.
So we've done a lot. RAD's done a lot of stuff over the years, but it's we've always kind of, and a lot of our guys, even that are game kind of programmers, have a background in starting compression, because I feel like that's a good place to be.
And Fabian, you presumably, I kind of know you did because I know you, but like, you did not start doing compression when you came to RAD, so how yeah. did you first, how did that come about as something you were interested in?
I can't honestly say, I don't know.
Okay.
It was just like,
well,
as soon as I knew...
was on video compression, right? Like, wasn't your dissertation?
My diploma thesis was on video compression stuff, but that was way after.
Okay.
When I first started, like, basically as soon as I learned that there was such a thing as data compression, like that there was a theory to it, and not just, like, there was, you had stuff like pkzip that you just knew how to use.
Right.
And that always seemed a bit magic. And then... at some point, I got some algorithms book or something that explained, I think, Huffman coding.
Oh, okay.
Which is one of the classic algorithms from the 50s to do this kind of thing. It's still practically irrelevant. And but once you learn about that stuff, it's like, oh, that's interesting. I'd like to know more. And then you start getting into it.
So let's start with some compression stuff here for people such as myself who don't really know what's going on. Jeff sent me some things that he was thinking about in terms of topics. It looks like Fabian's got some too. I just want to start with one question of mine, and then we can go with mostly stuff of yours, because you guys know more about how it should probably be laid out. My fundamental question is just like, okay, as someone who sort of knows the buzzword version of compression, like, you know, okay, that's, you know, LZ compressor or something like this, but really has a very shallow understanding of it, which is where I'm coming from. Could you perhaps give a sort of quick, I don't know, like, guide to just what is the way to think about, like, the compression family, if you will? Because there's lossy and lossless, there's back-end entropy, there's dictionary, there's all these things. And I feel like to start with sort of a little bit of a taxonomy, that as we go through this discussion, people can sort of understand and file into a good taxonomy of where these things are fitting into that process and where those lines are and how they blur. And so I just feel like that would be great, because I maybe have this one in my head that's probably not real great, and if you know you could kind of give us one that was better, that would be awesome.
Yeah.
Yep.
I could talk about maybe start and then so the way I think of David Stafford, who's a longtime compression guy, and in fact I think you'll be talking about him tomorrow at the software rendering stuff, since he was an early game guy, just a smart guy, been around for a long time. Used to have this thing, he'd ask people who worked in compression of what they felt compression was. You might guess whatever, you know, make this little guess, and he kind of used it as a game to start a conversation. And his answer...
And when you say what compression was?
Yeah, it's a more of a general thing of just, like, what do you think it means?
Like, what's it about?
Yeah, what's it about? And his answer was always prediction. Like, the better of a predictor you are, the better compression you'll get. Like, just in a very hand-wavy way.
And when you say predictor, he's basically meaning how well your compressor guesses what will come next.
Yeah, so there's this. So that's kind of what I was going to get to in how I think about compression. Is there's kind of two halves of it. There's like the first part is called modeling, and that is usually the prediction part of like your best guess of what's going to happen in a data stream or in a video stream or an audio stream or anything. You make a guess, and then you're wrong. Because you're always a little wrong. Your prediction isn't perfect, otherwise we would need it. You know, this would be a much easier problem.
Or in the case of Fabian's compressor that has the one bit that says this
is in the other
file.
Stream. Yeah. Right.
Or
right.
in the other stream, yes.
So So I sort of think about it as the modeling part, and then there's the part, the statistical end, the part where you have to clean up the errors, the residuals.
Okay.
So, and I think that's where the more interesting problem is, because you're never going to have perfect prediction, and the difference between really good prediction and okay prediction is you can get a lot of the way with a not great thing. So I sort of think of it as those two levels.
Okay.
And certainly like anything else, when you do it for a long time, the big wins come from blurring those edges of like, you start out when you write these things as you're going to write, oh, here's our this and here's our back end. And then over time, they blur together and you try to make a modeler that gives you things that the residual compressor can do better on and that kind of thing.
So here's a, like, I guess if I'm going to sort of try to break that down. So here's what I sort of got out of that in terms of the thought process. You tend to think of it as, when I'm looking at a compressor, I'm thinking about how I'm modeling what I expect this compressor to see in a very efficient, likely to be correct most of the time way, and how I handle the difference between its guess and the actual data that I was fed. And you're kind of mapping the parts of the compressor into a spectrum somewhere on this. And presumably, different compressors have different pieces that fall into those parts. Some maybe have multiple pieces that chain together.
And
some
you also have things that are multiple levels where you're predicting at one level, like in a PNG, you're predicting pixels, and then you follow that up by a pass that does an LZ, which was predicting bytes, and then you follow that up with a statistical end. But that's sort of how I break it down in my head.
Okay.
The two stages, but again, like once you're past kind of toy stuff, you start blurring those lines all over the place.
And with lossy versus lossless compression, like something like a JPEG versus a ping, it sounds like, and maybe this is not true, so correct me if this is a misstatement, but it sounds like you don't think of that as a big difference between these things. You think of that as more just like, well, I'm going to store all the data or I'm not, or the residual part.
Yeah.
I'm going to store all of that or I'm not, but I don't think of that as a real defining characteristic of the compressor or a way to think about these algorithms. That's more just
it's a critical part, and it's how all these algorithms work, but it's not how I classify it in my brain, and it might be different for other people. But,
Awesome.
I mean, the whole lossless stuff is just, they're different applications. Like if you're gonna do backups, you probably want a lossless compressor.
Yeah.
I'm gonna hazard that guess.
Depends what you're backing up.
Yeah.
True. Like in practice, like something like 80% of your backups you're never gonna look again.
Yeah.
So if your compressor is really good at predicting the parts that you actually need backed up.
Good point.
That will work. I mean, that's basically the name of the game.
Yeah.
But the big watershed between lossless and lossy is not that they use completely different techniques. It's just that with lossy compression, like if you look at if you were to plot a curve, like how many bits have I sent versus how good is the reconstructed data, how close is it to the original?
Okay.
In a lossless compressor, you just keep sending bits until that error is zero.
Yes.
Because everything else is not acceptable.
Okay.
A lossless compressor is one where you're willing to stop early.
Okay.
That's pretty much, and like you try to design the bitstream so that at any step of the algorithm, your options are such that you have a good way to just send a few bits and get a lot of information, like reduce the error by a lot.
Okay.
And like if you look at applications, in a game setting, like for example for networking, you will usually do lossy compression. For example, like dead reckoning and so on, like the stuff you send in a network packet will not give you the exact values back. It has limited resolution and so on because it doesn't matter that much.
So you're talking about in a game, a multiplayer game running over the network, and you're sending state packets across.
Yep.
Oftentimes you're saying you will even allow lossiness there because even though it's not an image or something like this, you just don't care enough about the precision.
Yeah, there's stuff like whatever the position of the player, you'll usually have like whatever 32-bit floats.
Yeah.
like for three axes, so you have 96 bits of position, and usually you will not send that whole thing.
I see.
You'll send something that has loss as a form of like, all right, that's
That's
forced compression.
Yes.
Okay.
No, I mean, you try to design the format so that if you lose a packet, like that degrades gracefully, which is another form of the modeling. Like you have to sort of design it into the system.
Very interesting.
And you basically try to distribute, like, that's actually for a network game that's very much designed in. Like anything that's important, like that's really important, that's like state changes, if you're going over something like UDP, which can drop packets, you just keep resending that data until the other end has acknowledged that, yeah, I've seen that. You might not resend it every packet, but you have to resend it periodically to make sure that eventually they see it.
Yes.
That's like, again, it's like you just have, first of all, there's this notion of error with lossy compression, of like how close is this thing I've sent up until now to what I actually want to have in the end. And you can also, like, from an application perspective, like, what does error mean? And it's usually about like either something about the fidelity of the thing you're sending, or it's just about how important it is.
And so I guess that you're just saying there's a definition of error, which is not necessarily about reproducing the data stream in some absolute sense. It's more about like what kind of differences we care about versus what kind of differences we don't.
Exactly. I mean, like in a network game, like if whatever, the match is over, that's important information, because that means you're going to go back to the lobby and you're going to keep resenting that, because like having the other game continue running game when all of the players have left is a fairly significant error.
Yes.
So you want to make sure not to make that mistake.
Yes.
Whereas other things, you might not care. Like, whatever. Okay. If it's some, they might decide, like, if you have really high traffic, you're okay with dropping chat messages, for example.
Oh, okay.
Or you might decide that you always want these because they're important.
Yes.
There's stuff like voice packets. There's stuff like, okay, whatever, random packets that just tell you to play a sound effect. If those get dropped, whatever. Not a big deal. Like, would be nice, but and so there's this hierarchy. Okay. So the lossless world is all about general purpose compression, where somebody just writes a library. Like, this is the thing that you just give an arbitrary file to, and then you expect to get that file back.
And these are generally not tuned. I mean, certainly some lossless compressors are tuned to a particular data type, I would assume, like text compressors or something like this.
Yeah, but it's fairly general, and like because the error always has to go to zero in the end.
Right.
They have to be, they're fairly
constrained. They'll both behave, they'll both give you back the same thing. You just might not get as much compression if you have an encoder that takes some special liberties with how binary data might be structured other than text data.
I see.
In the lossy world, it's a lot more application specific.
Yeah. So before we get too far into that, did you want to talk about how your mental model of compression as well? Because I didn't know if it differs, I mean, different, you know, perspectives, or was Jeff's actually somewhat similar to the way you think about it at a high level?
Similar. I mean, like, to me, it's a lot about just modeling.
Okay.
It's just basically, it's sort of a scientific process, more or less. Like, you just try to build this model of how data behaves.
Okay.
And how close or how not close you are is very easy to measure, and that's the amount of bits you have to spend in one way or another to just get that prediction with that model, which might be good or might be bad, to actually match the real data. I think that's part of why it is so addictive to some people.
Okay.
It's just that you have this very objective feedback.
Like, yes.
Mm-hmm. Like, there's no...
And you also have no absolute answer. Like, most of the time, you don't know what the smallest thing is, I assume. So there's always this sort of, like, reaching for the chalice thing where you think you could maybe get a little bit better.
Yeah, there's a funny thing of with compression, there's no... we don't even have, like, oh, this is entropically the smallest this amount of data ever. We don't have a way to even get to that. We can't even measure even smaller stages of, like, in an LZ compressor, you have something called the parse, which is how you break it apart. Maybe we'll talk about that in a second.
Okay.
But it's how you jump through a file. We don't even know a way to find a perfect parse for a given compressor. Like, you can lock some things down in hand wave.
Well, we do.
Well, it depends on if your stuff is if you're a dynamic system. Like, you have to, like, at some point estimate that, like, all right, I'm going to just, well, overall, this is close.
It's a practical problem.
Yeah.
At some point, you just don't want to spend, like, 5 weeks compressing a 4 kilobyte file.
Right, right.
But it's not, like, it's not, like...
You can get close.
Some of the stuff you say, like, what's the minimum size for this file? Like, that's actually mathematically undecidable. Like, that's, right. Halting problem level bad.
Yeah. And you also were suggesting that it depends. I mean, you're talking about a thing that compresses a certain corpus of data as well. Because, like you said, if you're just compressing purely general data, the answer is you can't compress it. Like you said,
overall, average out to the exact same size.
But so saying how small can this get is like, well, what you mean is how small can this set of things get on average?
Or within the system.
Within the system.
I mean, the stuff that Jeff was talking about were, like, we don't know what the optimal LZ parse or something. That's not actually true. Like, we can't determine that. That's literally just a shortest path search in a graph. Okay. Happens to be a really large graph and very diminishing returns.
Okay.
Yeah. But it's not like that's a completely solvable problem that is economically useless to solve, because, as I said, nobody wants to wait 3 weeks to compress a 4K file.
Right. Okay.
But, like, that is not the same level of we can't do this as, say, like, deciding what's the minimum size for this file outside of this framework of, like, within this encoding.
I see.
Like, within a given encoding, you can usually, like, there's a deterministic process which is literally enumerate all possible encodings up to a given length.
Right.
And, like, figure out if that gives you back the file you wanted.
Right, right.
Like, that one always works, and it's really shitty.
And okay.
There's way better ways to do that.
Okay.
Right? Like, for the LZ parse, it's usually not even, like, that bad. It's something like, oh, it's like n to the third power, n to the fourth power.
Okay.
And we still don't want to spend that amount of time, but that's not even an exponential search, so it's not that bad.
Yeah.
It's just still useless.
It's still useless.
So essentially, I guess the thing there is, for a given codec, we probably can run some exhaustive procedure, possibly optimized, to eventually determine what the smallest size of something is if that thing was within a fairly tractable bound.
Yeah. Yep.
Once it gets above that, we can't.
And then
if the question is how small can it get in general, we don't have any idea, because that once you take a particular compressor out of the definition, it becomes the fanciful
and
problem.
Once you're in the general space, you also have to somehow encode the decompressor itself. Because once you're in the space of all possible encodings, you're talking about, oh, I have to have this program that's the decompressor and then the data it takes that these two together produce the output.
Yes.
This is kind of the XE compression again.
Right.
Except when you doing this in a mathematical framework, you don't use something crazy like x86.
Right.
Like, lots of corner cases use a mathematical model that's nice and tractable, like a Turing machine.
Okay.
And, like, even defining that, like, oh, like, there's this notion called Kolmogorov complexity.
Okay.
Which is just Russian mathematician, as always, and Kolmogorov just defined...
Is it the good math that comes from Russia?
A lot of combinatorics and graph theory stuff and optimization stuff comes from Russia.
I see.
Moscow State University, 50s and 60s, good stuff. Like, a lot of that then got rediscovered later in the US, and, like, a lot of theorems, they had this all figured out way before, and it just, because of the Cold War
took a while
for that knowledge to propagate. But
okay,
the stuff that Kolmogorov did is just like, hey, it just basically has just this definition that you determine a program and the input data that together produces that output.
Okay.
Which is a nice, concise definition. You can write it down easily, and it turns out, as I said, it's completely undecidable.
Well, so, I guess that as soon as you include the program, then you are into all of the standard computational or computer science problems that you would have when you have a program, because presumably that program can do anything that a Turing machine can do.
I mean, that's exactly the kind of thing you run into. Whenever you have, and that's a very practical problem, so to get back to the ground floor here, it's like not... go too abstract, but the basic problem you have with compression is always that you have to sort of trade off what kind of thing am I going to put in the compressor.
Right.
There's lots of things you can, like, oh, this might be really useful to have in there, but it turns out, like, if you don't have this feature in the bitstream, this enumeration process, this decision process is really easy.
Okay.
And once you throw this thing in that has, like, a form of dependency, that suddenly means that, whatever, your only n squared algorithm or linear time algorithm doesn't work, and you're suddenly falling back to an exponential search. So you have to trade off, this makes the bitstream more expressive, but in a way that means that now all known ways to just find a good solution don't work. And if you have, if that's only the stuff that's guaranteed to give you the optimal solution, you might, whatever, I still have heuristics. And my heuristic solve with this more expressive format gives better results than the optimal solve for the less expressive format. And then you might decide you want to do that.
So let me just unpack though, because we haven't quite gotten down to that level yet. So I want to just go over that. I think I know what you were saying, but I just want to make sure. So essentially what you're saying is, okay, I'm writing a compressor. Mm-hmm. And you know, I am creating, you know, the definition of this compressor means I'm going to have the decompressor is kind of sort, I guess, the definition of the compression, how it works. Because like if I can write the decompressor, now I have completely specified what this format is in some sense. But although I could make that thing have arbitrarily complex pieces in it, some of those may imply that the compressor, in order to pick optimal or good compressions, now is somewhat intractable or practically intractable in some way. Is that okay?
I mean, that's not a theoretical thing. If you look at things like video compression, like all the MPEG standards used to be just they specify the decoder.
Like,
they did not have any provisions for how do you even encode this.
I see.
And for a long time after the specified MPEG, they had an idea for how you can write a program that generates a valid encoding. Like, they weren't good. Like, that's why they, like, the theory of like how to write something that generates a good output, like for a human looking at this, like this looks kind of close. Even if you look at like now considered old codecs like MPEG 1, by the time they spec'd MPEG 2 and then the first parts of MPEG 4, like we hadn't figured out how to do a good encoder for MPEG 2 yet. And with what we know now about current video formats, you can do way better encoders for MPEG 2 as well.
Right, so if you went back now and wrote the encoders, you wouldn't even have to change like the format for a DVD. You could just get better looking video because the encoders would just produce better bit streams.
And that's also like part of what happens. Like that's why like the even at the same bit rate, the video you see on a DVD will usually be better than what you have in a TV broadcast scenario with the same bit rate. Simply because like if you have somebody doing a DVD, A, they have more time to spend on encoding in general, and B, they literally just have somebody going over the scenes, like looking at them individually. It's like, oh, this needs more bit right here, whatever.
I see.
If you're mastering a DVD for a feature film, like having somebody spend 2 weeks looking at every frame of the picture and deciding, like, oh, this needs a bit more bits here, and like it's lost in the noise.
Yes.
There's so many other costs with mastering that it's worthwhile doing that.
I see.
Whereas on TV broadcast, it's like, no, like this this stream is going out right now, and it needs to be like on the screen in 15 seconds, and like you do whatever.
Okay. So it's kind of just grind the sausage, and whatever comes out the other end is dinner. Okay.
To put it another way as well, is this is something that a lot of times people don't realize is when you, say, zip a file, there isn't a exact, like, you can produce a zip file that will decompress to the same file, and there'll be lots of different fuzzy sizes.
Right.
Because the specification is overgeneralized in that way. Like you can have ones that do different things like that. So certainly the compressor, how you make those decisions on what the on what bitstream you feed to the decoder makes a big difference. And certainly some of the fast stuff that Charles and Fabian have been working on with Oodle is kind of taking that to an extreme of like writing parsers that generate files that can be decoded quickly, right? Like is a big part of what that win is. It isn't just like, and certainly, you know, at RAD we've always had this ability, you know, in the early days it was me when you were working on Granny, I'd help optimize stuff, and then we had Abrash and Sartan who would work on stuff, and now we have Fabian who's better than all of us put together, who can always kind of fill up the, you know, can kind of clean things up and make them fast at the end. But a lot of how you design these systems is writing things that are, by their nature, optimizable or like are fast.
Well, I remember that was a big part of the design of Bing 2 as well, was that, you know, that was the thing.
Do what you can decode quickly.
Yeah,
and then
because that's very important,
encoding.
And that's like get the best compression you can within a game time budget.
Especially for Bing 2, I remember like this was basically like the format was to a large extent dictated by having to decode it on an Xbox 360.
Yes. That was like the worst case
platform.
The
360 and the PS3 really killed us for a long time. They're not good chips.
I'm glad we don't have sponsors for this conference.
I don't think anybody.
I don't think you'd be sponsored by IBM and Microsoft and Sony decided to switch to AMD for the next generation.
That's a good point.
There you go.
That's a very good point. All right, so I don't know what's on your list, Fabian. So I guess you're gonna have. Okay, so should I ask some of these then, or did you have any topics?
Just go ahead.
Okay. So I guess these were from Jeff's original email, and I understood some of them, but I didn't understand some of them. I'll start with one that I did understand, which is you said modeling versus statistical was a topic. So you kind of touched on that a little bit, but it wasn't sort of directly addressed. So what did you want to start saying about that?
Well, part of it was just separating the idea of prediction and dealing with the residuals of how you think about compression. Like when you learn how to do compression, you kind of start down this path of like, all right, maybe the first thing you do is like, oh, I'm sending all these integers and they don't they're not all zero to FFFFFF. So like, all right, I'm gonna do some little bit packing thing of like, this value is only 7 bits, so I'm gonna shove 7 bits at the top of word instead. So you start and you like learn, okay, I made a bit packer and now I got that smaller. And then maybe you get a little fancier and do like multiplicative stuff where you're like, all right, now my value is not evenly not a bit. I'm like, oh, this is a value from, you know, 1 to 3, so I wanna multiply those out together. And so you kind of build on this. And then you start modeling where you're like, now I'm just not encoding the data, I'm like predicting the data and then dealing with the deltas. So it's
so let me just drill down on that, because this was actually something that, again, and like I said, kind of I'm trying to get the compression from a beginner standpoint, because it's not something we cover in Hammer Hero and it's not something that I know. So this was something that I've heard you guys talk about before, and it was a point that I think was worth internalizing, at least for me, because again, a lot of these things I'm sure are very simple for people who work on compression, but before you get into it, you don't have any traction on really what's going on. You know, you might read an algorithm and say, oh, okay, there's a Huffman codec, it does this on the bitstream, or here's an LZ thing and it does whatever. But the prediction thing, I'd just like to give an example of that, because one of the things that you were saying was like, okay, so for example, I have an image that I'm trying to compress, like, and maybe we're just talking about like one small subsection of the image that I'm trying to put out there. So a very simple thing that you mentioned was like, okay, oftentimes you can get much better compression if first, before you do anything, you just subtract everything from its neighbor first as a very simple thing, because it's very, very cheap to do, right?
Yep.
So actually not, but.
Okay. So could you just give a simple example like that for people who are more on my side? Because people out there right now are like, yeah, I know all this stuff. And we'll get to the more, you know, sort of maybe stuff that they're more interested in. But I just want, for people like me who are kind of like coming at it first time, can you give like a very simple example of that so that when we say prediction, it's not kind of fuzzy and it's more like, this is what we mean.
Can I?
Yeah.
Just for modeling. So what that means is you have some concrete expectation of how your data looks like. Like, if you think about the kinds of things, the kinds of knowledge and so on you can bring into, there's basically like two separate universes. One is kinds of things you know in general about the kind of data you're handling.
Yes.
If you're dealing with, say, JPEG, you know, like, that was developed for things like photographs. So, like, natural imagery, like, just digitized, whatever. And that has certain properties, such as, for example, that adjacent pixels tend to look similar.
Okay.
Which just means, on a very basic level, that if you take the pixel and its immediate neighbor, like, the difference between this element is likely to be small. And you can go a bit further and, like, look at, it's like, oh, these pixels are, in a statistical sense, they're correlated.
I see.
And if you go a bit further out, they're still correlated, it's just the correlation is weaker.
Okay.
And once you make that definition mathematically precise and how that looks, you can get to a certain model. And just working that chain of reasoning through the end, just that one statement of like, there's a correlation between adjacent pixels, and that correlation decays at a certain rate once you go further out.
Okay.
Just once you have that, model assumption, which sounds fairly reasonable, you get down to a chain of like, okay, if that is true about the data, then certain properties hold, and then the solutions to these things on a mathematical level have a certain shape. And there's a good approximation to doing that kind of transform, and that's the discrete cosine transform, which is why JPEG does that.
Okay.
So there's a mathematical transform that sort of has the right properties for data that has this shape.
Okay.
So that's a very concrete thing. The thing you have in text compression is similar. So there's these things called dictionary methods.
Yes.
And there the assumption is that if you have text, there's lots of repetition in there. And I don't mean repetition at a structural level, like, oh, this sentence sort of looks like the one before it. I mean very literally, like, this thing here is a word, the string of five characters.
Right.
And we see that word a lot.
Yeah.
So it might be worth just having a shorter encoding for this.
Yes.
That's where the whole LZ thing comes into. There's two guys, Lempel and Ziff, who did two papers on this in 1977, 1978, called imaginatively LZ77 and LZ78.
Yeah. Do compression people generally put their name on stuff?
It's just, that's how everybody cited it. Okay. I don't think they actually named them that way. It's
okay.
just like a string substitution method, whatever, and like nobody cites the whole paper. It's just like
LZ77.
The citation's LZ77 and the name stuck.
Very good.
There's an interesting point there where that was a watershed moment when these papers came out, because there was a funny thing of people thinking about compression in terms of Huffman and arithmetic and getting to the point where we're like, we're doing the best we can.
Okay.
And then these guys came in with these fairly simple algorithms that were just this huge jump in complexity versus compression. So it was a huge deal. And most encoders to this day are LZ77 based. Like,
well, for lossless.
Yeah.
And like the whole assumption there is like you can go down the road if you're in the whole statistical compression world. Like Karl Magaroff, Markov, and so on, like all things you hear a lot in this context is all like stochastics.
Okay.
That's like probability theory in its modern form came out of Russia, so that's also why these Russians are very predominant there.
Okay.
That's where that sort of comes from. And if you go down that road, you get modern statistical compressors, which are basically just, you look at data and you try to build a stochastic model, like what's the most likely thing to happen next, and you get probabilities and you try to encode that thing. Like that's what's called statistical compressors. They look at some form of this.
And so what are some examples of statistical compressors, like name-wise? So
Huffman, for example, is like a form of statistical compression where you look at the statistics of like how likely are each individual letter in the alphabet. Like E is a lot more likely than say Y is.
Yes.
So in that case, you want to assign short codes to the letter E and a very long codes to say letter Q, which is very rare.
Yes.
That kind of thing is under statistical compression. And then you can look at like, oh, what if I don't look at just a single character, but multiple characters, or I look at a single character, but also consider what went just before that character. Or you say, like, my model is not just what happened immediately ago, but also, like, other data I have seen, and I try to infer complex properties of the data I've seen so far in this stream. Like, the stuff I mentioned with JPEG is just general, like, things I know about the world, right? Like, I know how certain images look, and I use that to drive the compression. The stuff with statistical coders is more like, oh, I know about data that it is self-similar in a certain way, and I just try to learn properties of the data stream as I go along and I build that model.
So how would you define the split between something like an LZ compressor and something like a Huffman or an arithmetic compressor? In this, I mean, obviously they can be used together, but I mean those separate algorithms, because in some sense the description that you just gave could sort of apply to an LZ compressor. It's sort of a statistical compressor.
Yes.
It's like as I see things, I know I can reference things that I've already seen, and that there's a certain cost to that, so I might adjust my et cetera, right?
It's mainly a matter of how you think about it. Like LZs can be fully understood as just this is a form of so-called Markov model.
Okay.
Markov model just means that you predict the data you have right now from data you've seen in the past.
That's
really all that means.
Okay.
You can go a bit more precise about what that is, but that's really all it boils down to.
Okay.
And that's a fairly basic thing.
Okay.
But the string matching stuff you have in compression like LZ means that you don't have any kind of repetition. It has to have a certain structure. You encode that in a certain way where you write down an offset, like this is where that string was, or you build an explicit dictionary of words and you say this is word number 351.
Yes.
So that's a bit more explicit than just saying like, oh, I have a general probability model. It's like
I see.
Markov models in general are a very general theory, very general abstraction. But you can apply that sort of thing to everything. The string matching thing and the dictionary thing is a lot more specialized, but has structure like, oh, like it doesn't break stuff apart between bytes or something like that.
Right.
You can do a lot nicer modeling. You can do a lot like string searching and so on. We have good data structures for that. So there's lots of leverage there of working at that string level. So the LZ stuff tends to be a lot faster. But like from a mathematical point of view and like from a theoretical point of view, it's just a Markov model. Yeah. It just happens to be the type of Markov model that's most efficient by an order of magnitude.
Yeah.
Okay.
I can give a so just talking about prediction versus the encoding, I can give you one, just a very simple way to think about it that's less mathematical, of like a specific case of, you can imagine an image that was just a wash from 0 to 255.
Okay.
Okay. And you have a very simple back end of your image encoder that is an RL that just encodes runs. It says like, okay, there was a zero and there was 25 of them.
Right. Okay, very so simple, very simple thing that's just like, I'm going to just give a count and a value,
yeah,
and we're just going to assume that way if the whole thing was the same color, I just send two things down, two bytes down, and we're done.
Right. So if you have that back end and you feed it the wash, it's not going to do very well because every pixel is different from the previous one.
Right.
So, but if you add some prediction to it and subtract from the previous thing, instead of a wash from 0 to 255, you end up with a big run, you know, a zero and a bunch of ones.
Okay.
So then all of a sudden, like, okay, now your prediction has helped the back end statistical part have an easier job. So that's kind of the split, that a very specific, simple way of thinking about.
And so in some sense, the predictions and the transforms, because the transforms are the predict, like, you could, I guess, assume you could think of these similar, like your predictor, your transform, whatever it is, it's the thing that you are using to try and make the data become as regular as possible for whatever you're feeding it into.
Yeah, yeah. Or just something that your back end is expects to see.
That thing, in some sense, moves your highly compressible stuff around in some sense. Like, mm-hmm. meaning, I've got, you know, all the things I might ever compress.
Yeah.
There's some things I compress very well and some things I compress very poorly. I'm trying with these transforms to move the things I care about into that good part, yep. and the things I don't care about out into the thing.
Right.
So ergo, in that example, if that was the only thing your compressor could do, you now have a much harder time with something, say, that, well, I don't know. Is there anything that
just like, does anything that oscillates or anything, you're going to not do well on.
Okay.
So, yeah. I mean, compression's sort of beanbaggy in that way, as you try to push in the places that you care about, and it bulges out in other places, and then you hope it's in the corner.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the general process when you do, like, any sort of compression task, is you initially start out with a stream that has lots of discernible structure, and, like, that you just kind of hammer away at. And as you do more and more, like, you have this stream of, like, this is like the structure you extracted, and that gives you nice structured data. And then there's the rest. And like these residuals, like, basically, like, at some point you have this dense neutron star of just completely random looking data.
I see.
Because, like, that's all the stuff that just doesn't match any prediction. And, like, that's random, like, in a fairly strong mathematical sense.
I see.
Like, if you run randomness tests on this, like, statistically random, various tensors we use for a random number generator, that's what that is. It is literally random. Like, it's unpredictable because whatever is left there.
If it
there,
was, you
it's just
you
like,
got it.
Yeah. That's all the stuff that didn't match any predictions you could make.
I see.
So that's the stuff that is really random in the end.
So in some sense, you could say after you are done with your compressor and you want to know if you found the smallest possible, you know, thing here, you would send it to a cryptographer. And if they could figure out anything about it, you didn't do as good as you thought.
That's correct, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. All right. Should I move on from there? Or
sure. Since this is about learning a little bit of compression, that having that separation between prediction and then the cleanup is part of how you get a foothold in this stuff.
Okay.
Especially when you start looking at this in general, you're kind of stepping into, you know, 100 years of thought about this stuff. So it's a way to, like, because there is a way there that you can move into this slowly. It's not magic. Like, you know, the joke of all kinds of stuff is when you need something to be esoteric and magic in a TV show or any fictional setting, it's either compression or cryptography. And these are things you can do the work yourself to.
I thought it was usually physics. Like, it was like quantum whatever. I was like, okay, everybody's brains turned off.
Yes.
We can just write whatever we want.
Once you're from there,
just need some fancy equations on a board and you're
exactly
totally
like,
safe.
You say this is quantum something, so like, why is like, this is an accounting equation. What are you doing?
Yes. Well, see, that's why it's very good that I don't know any quantum math, because this way I can still enjoy the blackboards and TV shows. All right, so, The next thing that you had on your list there was science versus art.
Oh.
And I guess I have a fairly good idea probably what you're talking about there, but
yeah,
why don't you explain that
kind of
intro?
Yeah, and this is a little more hand-wavy, but it's kind of interesting, and I find it fun to think about, which is just, like I say, most general-purpose data compressors are based on an LZ-style algorithm.
Well, the ones you use. There's lots of really, really
weird stuff.
Like,
yeah.
We're talking about stuff that works at amazing rates of tens of kilobytes a second.
Right.
That compresses way better than anything you've ever used, and you won't use it.
Yeah, you will
it's
never
so
use
slow.
It. Yeah, yeah.
But it exists.
The ones that you use in practice are all based on this these exact same things. But we have made big strides in compression over that period of time too. And a lot of that is kind of the how good a compressor is really is how long people get to fiddle with it. Like how many things they can try, how many experiments can you run in a given time? Because you always have, at some point you have to ship. But a lot of this is the time you take and the amount of data sets you have and the things you're thinking about. And even now, like, we'll find surprising things. Like, a lot of, even as recently as the beginning of the year, Charles would discover things in his own algorithms, like, oh, hey, there's a parse here that I had not anticipated.
Should we mention the fact that the reason why we don't have all three people who work on compression at RAD is because Charles is in Hawaii?
Charles is in Hawaii. All right. Yes, he's on the beach.
We are in the rain here.
Do you think
he is in Hawaii.
That's right.
Laughing at us.
He's watching the stream on a beach, drinking a Mai Tai.
Yes, exactly.
Going, no!
Okay, so.
That's wrong.
And he forfeits his right to tell you that you said something wrong if he's not here.
I'm sure he will blog about it.
Yeah. Okay. That's the,
don't go to Charles's.
Okay, so yes, for those of you who don't know who Jeff is.
Don't go to Charles's blog.
Was Charles Bloom. who is another compression guy.
You become complicit as his therapist in his blog, so if you...
That's could, not
It's
nice.
A public service chip.
Yeah, okay. Right. Yes. So anyway, continue with what you were saying. So you said Charles found things in his own algorithm.
Yeah. Like, we had a fairly lumpy statistical compressor.
I'm sorry, lumpy?
I call it that. That's not a thing.
Well, you didn't say science versus art, so I'll give you that.
There's a continuum from things that I call them lumpy compressors, but they're things like LZ4, where you are doing fairly big symbols. You're sending nibbles or you're sending bytes. In this case, Charles was sending full bytes.
Okay.
Not doing individual bit packing stuff, doing encoding big things, because then you can write a byte faster, then you can pack words together and slide them over and shift them and OR them and all that. So the really fast encoders or decoders like LZ4 and stuff are like, make some concessions to compression by not going quite as high bit packing. So I call those lumpy. Then there's.
I'm sorry, I just want to get a little clarification there, because when you say bit packing, I just want to make sure I know what you're talking about. Are you talking about packing? Because I'm assuming you're not talking about packing bits on the output side. You're talking about the splitting up of bits on the input side.
They're on the output side.
Give me a little more, because I'm not sure I understood that exactly.
Well, okay, so
bit packing.
What's an easy way?
Okay, I mean, so bit packing.
LZ77, the way these compressors work at the very very high conceptual level is you are about to decode a byte. Or that symbol, and you look at a bit and it says, I am going to send you a literal, which is the byte that was in the input stream. I'm just going to send it to you.
Okay.
I might encode it, but I'm going to send you that. Or it's a thing that says, I want you to look backwards in the stream at this offset and this length and copy that data into your stream.
Right.
Okay. So if you are going back and forth on a single bit on every symbol, you have has a lot of ramifications in terms of branch prediction and speed and all this. So what LZ4 and other people do, and even earlier compressiveness certainly, but what LZ4 really, really leaned on it was saying that, all right, well, I'm going to encode like, and this isn't exactly what they, but like I'm going to encode 4 of those literal flags in a nibble, and then do all the things.
Okay.
Or like you can see things of like, all right, I'm going to try to get more out of each little symbol that I'm pulling out of the stream, so I can do some more stuff for speed purposes.
So as a general rule, if you're just outputting a variable number of bits at each step, then you just need to like read everything with get bits, and you need to keep track of where you are in the middle of a byte and so on. That's very complicated. Very complicated. It's, not, it's like 5 instructions, right?
Yes.
But it's complicated compared to just getting a byte.
Right, yes.
So the really fast compressors try to not have any complicated unpacking work as much as they can. They just try to like, oh, look at this byte, do this next.
Jump into a table.
Maybe do an and, like do an addition, but that's about the size of it. Like, don't try to keep track of the state in the bit buffer or whatever. Just don't do any of that.
I see. And so basically what you're saying is, okay, I have this decompressor. It's reading sort of a hybrid command data stream, right?
Yep.
Because it's sort of, you know, it, although it's all data, some of it is telling it sort of what to do, and some of it is telling it what to do it with.
Yep, right.
And so that is a, you know, you sort of created a new compression problem for yourself inside your old compression problem, which is, I now need to figure out how to most efficiently encode the way the decompressor is supposed to be working.
Yes.
And now you are running into the same problems.
Which, by the way, like, you're starting to, like, every compression scheme, as you add more of these methods, like ways of prediction, like that's one way that, for example, Rich Geldrich, who's like author of Crunch and like has written LZ Hammond, a couple other things, so another compression guy that we know, like he tends to think of this as basically like specifying a VM.
Okay.
The decompressor has like this set of commands it can do.
Yes.
And like it tries to like, this is a compact encoding for telling the decompressor what to do.
Right.
And like he's thinking of it in terms of like, oh, I've read this virtual machine and I have to basically write this compiler that generates code that the decoder VM then runs to reconstruct the data I want.
Right.
Yeah. That's another way of thinking about it.
Although unlike a traditional compiler, you now care very much about the executable size, whereas maybe before your trade-offs were
there
usually
there are compilers that go in that direction.
Certainly.
I mean, the stuff
well,
you do
well even
with,
standard compilers you know, have this option, but I mean, this is critical for this kind of compiler at that point.
I mean, that there's the specialized languages, there's compilers that really go towards, like, if we say optimization on a C compiler, that's a very hand-wavy thing.
Yes.
Because, like, optimal is really not very well defined. There's more application-specific languages and stuff for like compiler for, say, finite state machines and hardware, that when they say optimal, they mean optimal, as in like there literally is no better solution for the problem as specified in form.
I see.
And there's this continuum in between.
Okay.
So the compiler in that sense.
Got it. Okay. Sorry, so continue.
Oh, so anyway, so
bit packing, I'll back up for you.
Yeah, okay, so you have... So
Charles
you have
was looking at things of how he was packing those bits for the
Yeah,
the
so you have these, you know, that lumpiness, then you have Huffman, which is now pushing bits together, which is still lumpy, but less lumpy, and then you have arithmetic, which is partially bit. Anyway, there's this spectrum of, like, how this stuff's stored.
Okay.
Anyway, in the real lumpy...
On the Jeff Roberts lumpiness
Yeah, in the
spectrum.
Lumpiness scale.
Yes.
So one of our encoders operates on bytes and so it's very lumpy. And it was in January where Charles was like, just came back and said, hey, I'm getting a lot more compression, I'm a lot faster. And it was just changing the way he thought about the parse. So there's, and we think there's, in Charles specifically, thinks there's air there. But
this is, by the way, good moment to introduce what a parse is.
Yeah.
Like this LZ thing, like LZ is just literally about looking for string matches. Like you look at, oh, I have this string of whatever 5 bytes, and I already saw that earlier, and you just coded reference to where.
Right.
That might be just a position, or it's usually an offset from the current position, so it's like whatever 4 kilobytes back, I saw this.
Yes.
Or you have more sophisticated thing where like maybe the decoder keeps track of an explicit dictionary, like there's other ways to code that.
Yeah. Right.
That's the basic idea.
So
this whole parse thing is just like if you have, say, the word the in English text. You've seen that word more than once in a document of any size. Like there's lots of possible ways to encode the word the with a back reference.
Right.
And these have different costs, right?
Yes.
If you use the one that was in the sentence right before versus the one that you saw like 5 Wikipedia pages back.
Yes.
Like they're a different distance from you, and the shorter distances you usually make shorter to code. So you have multiple ways of expressing the exact same data that have different costs. this LZ parse thing is about looking at all the variants you have of saying the same thing and trying to choose the option that is best. So there's different ways of encoding this thing, and like, oh, like if I do this, like if I encode this reference to the here, like it's just the three letters, T-H-E, but the word that I'm actually trying to encode here is the word thespian.
I see.
And like thespian we had like a bit a while ago, but like it's a much longer match.
Right.
So like, even though the three letters I see here I could do immediately, if I just write somewhat longer offset and like look a bit further ago, I can code a lot more letters and it's worthwhile.
I see.
So it's all about looking at these different ways of encoding the same thing and trying to decide which option you want to take.
So the phrase
and not just for size, which usually what you do, but you might have two things that even you have two choices that are the same size and encode it, but one might decode faster because, like, oh, it's aligned, or it's or it's close, or it's so there's a lot of hard problems there.
So essentially,
and that's why I think there's a lot of error in parse. It's like I think people will
mind like if you're looking at it from a statistical modeling point of view, the fact that you have multiple ways to say the same thing is just
bad.
It's a bug. Like,
right. Yeah. Okay.
From that point of view, it's like there shouldn't be. Like that just means that the probability for these letters being THE should be higher or lower than it currently is. Like the fact that you have multiple ways of saying that means that you're underestimating the probability. And if you did that right, that wouldn't be the case. It would be baked into the model, right?
So I feel like that's one of those things that when you said it, I'm like, yes. But then if I think about it, I'm like, I am not actually prepared to re-explain that to anyone because it's a little slippery, right? Because it's like, okay, what do you mean by getting the probabilities right? Because in LZ, it's a dictionary thing. So you're saying that just inherently can't encode this concept correctly?
The dictionary thing is like it's a constrained thing. Like the fact that there's multiple possible encodings for the same thing.
Yes.
If you look at it as a Markov model, if you do a full-on statistical modeling, at each step, I'm going to crunch the numbers, like get the eggheads to figure out what the exact probability of the next letter is, and like encode that properly. If you were to do that, this ambiguity would not exist. You have the model says this is the prediction, and like you would work with that.
Okay.
But like, why would there be multiple ways of saying the same thing? That's inherently wasteful. If you think about it in terms of like going back to the way beginning, you have like these things, of list of things you can say, and you're mapping these to a different set. Like having two things in this set, in the smaller set, that say the same thing means there's really wasted bits. Because like these two things expand to the same thing, so there's a redundancy here that we could exploit.
Right, because there are two things that I could have encoded that both would have yielded the same result that just fundamentally means I wasted a bit.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, and with LZ, like that's a lot of bits. Like there's a lot of variability.
Right.
Same with MPEG encoding.
Okay.
MPEG has all these motion vectors and so on. These are not very well specified at all. There's even inside a frame. There's, I would say billions. Like, just be aware that this is wrong in the exponent by like a factor of like, it's like, billions is way too little.
Okay.
Like there's something like 10 to the 40 or so different options of coding a single MPEG frame that are meaningfully close in cost and so on to what you were like. It's ridiculous.
Right.
Because there are like, there's thousands of bytes and like, there's tons of decisions you make that you really can't justify other than this is what the heuristics told me.
Okay.
Like, if
and
you
that
were
doesn't
to
even get into the next frame, which might be referencing that one,
right,
so you
right.
might make a worse decision, a better decision on this frame that hurts you in the long
run.
We got a time. I just want to make sure I know where we are.
It's 10:50.
10:50. Okay, perfect.
You just have a lot of.
Should we start talking faster and compress the speed?
I just wanted to give you guys because this is.
We need to make this even denser.
It ends at 11:15, so I want to make sure you guys know you're kind of coming into your last 25 minutes there. I don't want you to miss anything you really want. So anyway, keep going.
Yeah. So the whole thing there is. All these codecs that in practice, like they have this massive amount of redundancy where you can express the same thing in lots of different ways. And from a purely compression, if you care about the minimum size thing, that's a waste.
I see.
Turns out we actually like having that kind of redundancy for different reasons.
Okay.
One reason is that we might want to write a fast encoder. that will never produce, be able to produce most encodings, because like all that subtle stuff with a the versus thespian and stuff like that, we just never even consider those.
Just go fast.
We just do the first thing we come up with and just roll with it.
This is your example of the TV, the live TV compressor. It's like, look, we just need something that's going to spit out an MPEG stream. It's just got to be close enough.
Yep. Exactly. If you're at Facebook, whatever, serving like compressed documents, you don't care about squeezing out the last 5 bytes.
Right.
If that's going to mean you spend like another CPU second of time, that's completely ridiculous. You don't care.
Okay.
Like, you would rather send less bytes than more, but you're not willing to spend infinite amounts of CPU time on doing it. In fact, you're not even willing to spend a lot of CPU time doing it. Like, you have very limited budget. You might have things like, because the way I encode these things is kind of heuristic, I might want to have encodings in there that I'm never going to use ever, but that are useful as stepping stones from getting from A to C. Because that having that B step in between, if I can go from here to here to here, and my optimization thing is kind of local, where it changes from A to B, and then B to C, and I would never try A to C directly, it can be useful to have intermediate steps in that encoding that even though you're not going to use, make it easier to find the things that you do want to use.
And you're talking about this from the standpoint of the encoder, meaning the decoder can't even read this intermediate conceptualization.
No, it might be a thing that the decoder can read, but it's just like, if you look at it like on the whole, like, sending
really
B was never a good idea.
Okay.
You either care about this thing or this thing, and in one case A is the best, in one case C is the best, and B never really makes sense. But having that thing in there as a potential thing that the decoder can decode, just getting from A to B, like if you have this optimization that tries to do incremental changes, it can be helpful having that in there.
Very true. So what you're saying is essentially getting back to sort of the optimal parse concept, which if I could restate that, because I think you guys sort of summed it up there, was just, I have a decoder, it's got a specific spec, I've got an encoder, and I want to basically produce the best possible thing for the decoder, given some metric, which could be, you know, speed, it could be size, it could be a combination of the two, it could be anything, who knows what. The optimal parse is the thing that processes the input data that you know, picks those choices for the decoder among equivalent options that yields that best possible result.
And that often is, as said, some incremental procedure.
And
so you start with some fast encoding. You just use a fast encoder to get an initial estimate of how big this should be.
Yes.
And then you try to make local changes of like, oh, if I do this and this and this, I get from here to here with less cost, and that's worthwhile.
So it's like a permutation-based search where we're sort of saying, okay, we know this encodes the frame. Let's see what happens when I try this.
Yep.
Now I see that it got smaller, and so that, you know, you could do that. I think the text, for example, I could start changing things in the LZ stream and as it goes.
Yep.
Is it fair to characterize the thing you said earlier as being that there is no such thing as a search for an optimal parse if your compressor was perfect in the way you described before, meaning there would only be one way to encode the data because we've squeezed every last probability piece out of it. So now the encoder is just direct. It just takes a thing and it goes, oh, there's only one way to encode this, only one way to encode this.
The really high-end...
But that never happens.
The really high-end statistical compressors are exactly like that.
Okay.
They have a very complicated model they're running. The decoder has to do almost exactly the same work as the encoder because they stay
they're
in sync.
They're keeping the same
tables. Where something like LZ, like you have to look like... The LZ encoder has to look for all the possible string matches. It has to decide which the best one is.
Right.
The decoder just says, like, oh, copy string from there, this many bytes, okay, go.
I see, yes, okay.
So, like, LZ is an example for a very so-called asymmetric scheme.
I see.
Which means that the decoder has very different workload from the encoder. So the encoder does all the string matching, it has to look at the parse, and has to do all the trade-offs.
That makes perfect sense.
Has to figure out what the right Huffman table to use is, where to put the split points, blah, 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 all these kinds of things. The encoder just says, like, oh, here's this Huffman table, go, oh, copy that many bytes. And so like,
I see.
Something like zip takes whatever, couple, is usually something like 5 times or so faster to decode than it is to encode.
Yes.
And that can become arbitrarily large.
If you just let it keep trying things.
If you don't use zlib, like Google has this compressor, for example, for the zip format called Zopfli.
Oh, okay.
That's a heavily optimizing zip compressor.
Yes.
That can take hours to compress.
Because it just tries.
Yes. It just tries lots of things. And like you can dial how long you want to wait and so on. But that's sort of stuff like, okay, they have, say, the style sheet that they're serving for the Google main homepage.
Yes.
If they're going to serve it to 1 billion people a day,
right?
Like saving that one byte might be worth it.
Right.
It's just like, and it's like, they don't change that all that often.
Right.
Like, letting that run for half an hour, if they do change the master style sheet or the JavaScript, is not a big deal for them.
I see.
But the 10 bytes they save doing so, I mean, it just all adds up.
So would it be fair to say that something like an arithmetic encoder, mm-hmm. right, which is sort of one of the statistical yep. encoder backend ideas, is, would it be fair to say that that is a, like, compression scheme that has, in some sense, been finished? Meaning, we have now gotten to the point where, for the definition of the problem as we spec'd it for this codec, we do not need to parse the data because it is exactly perfect for the entropy that it's encoding. Like, there is nothing left to wring out of its model, or is yeah. that an unfair characterization?
The arithmetic coding and, like, all the statistical things are just, like, you have, these are very mathematical things.
Yes.
There's a transform, and this does that thing. There's no degree of freedom there.
Right.
There actually is a tiny bit of freedom in arithmetic coding.
Okay.
The way we usually
the
implement
practical,
it.
Yeah.
Because
oh, okay.
like, there's, you have to want to, if you do this on a mathematical point of view, you just do this with exact big integer arithmetic. Like at some point, you just deal with 2048-bit integers and you hate your life.
Yeah.
In practice, we don't do that because that's horrid and slow.
Yes.
So in practice, we just say that, okay, limit the amount of numbers we deal with to like 32 bits or 64 bits or less.
I see.
And that means that in some cases, like we run out of precision, and in that case, we just agree on a protocol for what the decoder and encoder do. In that case, we just truncate the precision.
I see.
At that point, you lose a few bits, and you have, again, like possible encodings that this thing will never produce.
I see.
Because you limited the precision, but like that's like very, very small loss.
Yeah.
Okay. So
anyway, the whole art versus science, the whole point of that was that even among our own codecs that we wrote, there are new ways to dump out stuff within that, and that's kind of that how long can you spend on this? Do you discover these things? And that's the thing that, as a beginner, isn't something you think about. You're just trying to get it working. And
right,
you're trying
right,
to get
yes.
to, and you might iterate on trying to make something smaller, but not even thinking about these big, higher order, more complex things now. Like, hey, the parse is like a huge part of your, huge magic part that happens that you kind of just
right.
hand wave over usually.
And since it is, in general, it sounds like going to be sort of a large search kind of a problem,
yeah.
those are always kind of heuristically
yep.
sorts right. of things.
And, Charles yeah. says, like, I feel like there's, it's just an intuition. I feel like there's this huge space, and I feel like there's other unexplored spaces
that
in
someday
it
we'll find.
That someday, all right, well, this will be better compression at a much higher cost, or this will be much faster with, yeah. All, anyway.
I mean, we do have some evidence for this.
Yeah.
And that this is just an experiment, like I accidentally more or less ran beginning of the year, which was just like, oh, I looked at a file, and I was like, I've changed something in the encoding, and suddenly the file got massively bigger. I was like, what happened? It's like, oh, and then it prepend a single zero byte in front of the file, and now it's 4K smaller. So what the hell?
Okay.
All kinds, like this, like, okay, this must be a horrible bug, whatever. And then I tried this with a couple other compressors and had the same effect.
Okay.
Not always in the same direction, mind,
yes.
but you add like a single byte in front of the data stream and suddenly everything changes and it's like massive swings, like 10, 20 kilobytes, whatever.
Okay.
It's like huge stuff, like for a 1 megabyte file, that's fairly significant.
Yeah.
Right, right.
I mean, in
sure.
compression terms, like,
right, yes,
that's
certainly.
Huge. We would kill for like 20K
savings. Yes, yes,
and, like,
certainly.
Oh, we made the input file bigger and it got smaller.
I mean, a compression
like,
person
okay,
is somebody.
There's space yeah. there that, yeah.
A compression person is somebody who thinks that 20 bits is a lot of data.
Yeah.
Okay.
So,
that's the
yes.
definition of
compression. Yeah, pretty much. So.
After it's somebody who thinks that perpetual motion is going to happen.
Yeah.
So
those are the compression cranks.
That's okay. Okay. All right.
But you have that kind of thing, and that's just an artifact of there being all kinds of weird state and feedback loops in these encoders. So yeah, it just turns out like having that slightly different seed of having that 1-0 byte there just means that the starting conditions are slightly different, and it's this weird chaotic system. There's feedback in there. It just means that the search ends up in a very different place.
Yeah.
Yes.
And just changing that initial condition a tiny bit means you find very different solutions that are better or worse.
Yes.
So it's very much unstable in that sense.
And so in some sense, these searches do have a tendency to get stuck in local maxima.
Yeah.
And
definitely,
you can just happen to do something that kicks it out of that.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden you found a much better thing.
Yeah.
But
there's a lot of
currently
work
it's
on,
not clear
yeah.
how to actually design it
warm
to not
that up
find
and,
that
yeah, yeah.
other than, like you said, designing very long running ones that do the standard kind of like,
yeah.
you know, searching lots of different spaces and all.
But I mean, just seeing that kind of stuff happen with both your and everybody else's compressors just means like there's no question that there is like a lot of air left.
Yeah.
For compression values of a lot of air, like we can get a whole percent, man.
Yeah. yeah.
Not a joke. Yeah.
So I think we're getting close
there's
to
a,
the...
There's another interesting part just...
Oh, yeah, so we're getting close to the end,
really...
so I just wanted to say let's do anything that you guys really
okay,
want
well,
to
well, this
cover.
Is just a...
But
just
yes.
really quickly. I mean, the funny thing about this is since the encoders for these systems are very complicated now, they're getting more so all the time, and since the rule is you generate a file that can decode to the same file that was given you on input, you can have bugs in there, and Charles has had bugs in there that... were there for a long time because they generated correct files.
Right, right.
And it generated an okay parse, not the best parse. And then later on you find, oh shit, that level, that weighting was wrong or this decision was wrong or whatever. But it still works. So even aside from the error in the parse, you also have like, these are incredibly complex systems. And like it's, there's bugs like, in everything. So
do you generally, I mean, I guess, is it just the case that most of the data you work with is simply too large to ever try to run exhaustive searches on anyway, so you literally have nothing to compare to? You just run the thing, it gets the size it gets, and you just really try to look at the
Charles
code to figure out.
Charles and I talk about it, but
okay.
it was a magic way to like, yeah.
But
how
it sounds like you
are.
Never do.
No.
You never, or do you?
We have, like in OODLE, there are certain compression levels that exist that we don't even document. because they're just too slow to use.
Okay.
Like, nobody wants to wait that long like, for practical data, but they exist in some of the encoding, in some of the coders. And they're literally just there basically as ground truth for us.
So they're there as a sort of like, okay, let's double check. Can the like you know really long running one, does it get any better? If it
yep.
does, it means maybe we could do a little better with the heuristics
yes.
here, that kind of thing, to give you a little.
Yep.
Okay.
That's like, last year, Charles did a lot of work on one of the compressors that was motivated by like, oh, like or the thing we actually ship and tell people to use had certain kinds of files where it was much worse than the way better solution that we have lying around.
I see.
Also ships, but that we don't tell people to use, and that because it's just too slow to be practical.
I see.
Because it runs at whatever 50 kilobytes a second,
right.
and nobody wants to wait that long.
Yes.
So we had that kind of thing. We're just knew that there is a right way to do this that'll give much better results.
Totally. Yeah. The only other thing I don't know that might be fun to talk about briefly, depending on how much time, is just talk about kind of the optimization of these modern decoders, because there's
sure.
some interesting stuff there that I find fascinating.
Well, how much time do we have left?
Yeah, that's a good question.
Just want to make
10
sure.
10 minutes.
10 minutes? All right, so yeah. 10 minutes.
Okay,
go.
Well, so one of the things in an LZ compressor, you have these very tight, small loops. They're very tiny, or even a Huffman decode, they're very simple stages, like there's 4 or 5 instructions, and you can't squeeze a lot of air out of 4 or 5 instructions. You can go, you're already pretty tight. But in the modern stuff that Fabian and Charles did, they've done a bunch of things that rely on really advanced optimization techniques that aren't talked about a lot, of like exploiting how CPUs work nowadays, which is they aren't just running one instruction at a time, they're doing a lot at once. And
okay.
you want to talk about like multiple streams of a Huffman?
So you're talking about instruction level parallelism.
Yep.
Yes,
the concept,
which is not
that,
something
like...
you think about a lot in parallelism, but it's, you know, there's, that's 4 or 5 or 6 on a modern CPU, and some CPUs don't even have 6 cores. So like, there's a lot to exploit in just instruction
okay.
parallelism.
So just to make sure everyone knows what that is, because again, like we don't do a lot of optimization on Handmade Hero, certainly not like
yeah.
any really aggressive stuff at this point. So instruction level parallelism, in fact, why don't you guys, if you want to do it, but basically you're just talking about, hey, a single core of a CPU, just single threaded,
right.
has a number of sort of ports it can use to execute things.
Yep.
And if you fill all of these ports, you know, very efficiently, you know.
With a lot literally of can't. It's not possible.
Yeah.
If you fill a good percentage of these ports on every cycle, then you are going to get a lot more out of even the single-threaded code than if you are constantly waiting on one particular port to fill. Is that, that's what we're talking about here. Okay.
And what usually blocks these ports from being filled is like you have an instruction stream that's dependent on stuff that happens before, so it can't do the next instruction until it retires the old one, and then you're like, all right, all these, but so you
because these are out of order processors we're talking about here, so they are looking ahead to find something to execute, but when it tries to look ahead, it sees all of the instructions in the window all depend on something that is currently blocked, and then all of your ports stop
being filled. So you can imagine with a stream, you can't decode the next thing until you got this one.
I see. So the basic thing is, like, if you have running a regular loop, whatever, for I equals 1, and then I to n, like this kind of thing, right?
You are so going to run out of room.
This is like I
like that you put
scrolls.
The bracket on the
it
end
scrolls.
Of the line, though.
We
oh, it does.
Scroll.
All right.
Yeah,
you do thing with x of I, right?
Yeah.
And this does a thing. The whole point of this, in and out of our order processor, like these different invocations of do thing, like you can start do thing of x of 0, but the processor just looks ahead. It's like, oh, I'm going to do this probably with x of 1, x of 2, x of 3, x of 4, and just keeps going ahead. Like, do thing. Like, it's maybe this thing where, like, I have to do A, then I have to do B, and then I have to do C, right? And these all take some amount of time.
Okay.
Like, this might be completely serial execution, like, oh, like, multiply this by 3, add 2, whatever, don't care, something like this, like, some computation. The trick is, like, in and out of order processor, like, if you have, like, this is for x0, and, like, this uses some amount of resources, and, like, there's a lot of weight here, right?
Sure.
And then you can also do, like, okay, for x of 1, I can just start executing, like, pretty much as soon as I see this loop, the processor can go, like, oh, I'm going to run this for x of 1 as well. At least it thinks it will. It might be wrong, but it just forges on ahead.
Right.
And it's like, okay, like this.
And because the loop is large, that's probably, or at least if you cared about the speed of it, it's probably large, so you're, you know,
and so like,
fine.
And then like the next execution is going to be like this, and like you have this chain again, A, B, C. And like that keeps going before this is even finished. And then like, X of 2 can also start. Whoops, this is terrible. Before any of that is finished, and so forth. So like you have this weird cascade where they can all start going in parallel, because fundamentally, this do thing here happens to be some operation where there's no dependence between what happens for x0, x1, and x2.
Right.
So these can all run in parallel, and they do.
Okay.
If the loop has that shape. The problem in most compressors is that everything has this shape. A, then B, then C.
Okay.
And it's the entire
it's
way
dependent.
Through. Like if you
so really what you're saying is that C kind of loops back up to the next A if we draw an arrow there.
So like we have
and so it's all just one big daisy
exactly.
chain.
Exactly. And like then you have this big daisy chain where there's one instruction going at a time and it's terrible.
Right.
The problem with something like Huffman coding is like, okay, you have you're looking at a certain number of bits, whatever, and you're looking at that bit stream trying to figure out how long that code even is, because they're variable length, and you can tell that by looking at the data. So you first figure out how long that code is, then you know how many bits to remove from the bitstream, and after that you can start decoding the next thing.
Right.
And like after you've decoded this thing, there may be other things you do that go off on the side that are not in the dependency chain.
Right.
And like those can just fill in the blanks.
Right.
But most of the stuff you do is just like, okay, this is my current value, how long is this code?
Yes.
Remove these bits from the bitstream, and then I can start the next value.
So basically, everyone will always block on that step, so you can't ever start the next thing you might want to do.
Exactly, because like there's
you don't even have the bits for it.
There's just this long chain of like, look at the code, figure out the length, remove those bits. Look at the code, figure out the length, remove those bits. And like that's
so there's only so much optimization you can do there. You can squeeze those few instructions in.
Right,
but,
right.
And we do. Those are all handwritten.
So A, B, and C can get as fast as A, B, and C possibly can, but they're never going to overlap with the next A, B, and C.
In the Huffman decoder example, like on one of the CPUs, this is literally three instructions.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Like literally.
Okay.
So like there's that's the entire decoder. There's just nothing else to do there.
Okay.
It's so, like three instructions per byte, but these are all dependent on each other.
Yes.
So your life sucks.
Okay.
There's just nothing you can do there. Unless you, like, in a regular loop, the CPU looks at this kind of shape of thing you're doing and knows, like, oh, I do x of 1, x of 0, x of 1, x of 2, and these are all independent. I can just do them in parallel. The CPU just does all that for you.
Okay.
If you have this kind of problem, and it happens to be serial, like, the CPU, like, there is an actual serial dependency from here to here, right? Like, that is not imaginary. Like, that has to be respected if the program is written that way.
Yes.
So if this can't be done in parallel, then you have to help the CPU by writing a different program that has some parallelism.
Okay.
So in this case, it's like, okay, well, if there's an actual dependency chain here, then I'm going to do three streams. Right? Where I just have, like, stream zero has A, B, C, and then stream one has one ABC.
So you're still coding symbols. You're just they're just and multiple ones, completely different streams. In within each stream, they're serial, but you're pulling symbols out of each one.
I see.
Yeah.
And so, you can go to pretty crazy lengths to where what do we have six streams in some of our stuff.
So basically, what you do is you say, all right, we want to try and get the instruction level parallelism up.
Yeah.
Yep.
We know we can't make this thing any less serial as an encoding, because the whole point of the Huffman is to make it so that it is serial, because anything we do that makes it less serial would waste bits.
Yes.
So let's just do more Huffmans, break the stream into multiple Huffmans, and do them all at once. That way you just get however much
so
instructional kind of parallelism as you like.
Grabbing a symbol off one stream, grabbing a symbol off another, grabbing a number there. So it looks like it looks like you're unrolling a loop, but you're actually unrolling it in
it's really
data
six
order.
It's six loops running in parallel, right?
Yes.
And that gives you the parallelism
six
you need.
Right.
And why six? It happens that this loop, like this critical path here, this part, A, B, and then C. Like, it just happens in this case. Like, why is it six streams? Because this here happens to take six cycles and has a shape that can start every cycle.
I see.
So you need six streams so this whole thing works out.
Works out.
It's just, and the thing is, like, there's other things you can do that go kind of along a similar vein where, like, oh, I can do this using SIMD operations and do four streams at a time. They have the same problem. Like, the SIMD stuff also has its latencies, and these latencies are actually larger. They're worse.
Right, yes.
So with SIMD stuff, it's actually, like, you can do the same thing, but the parallelism stuff doesn't go away.
Right.
You can also do that on top of the SIMD.
So
it's now that, you do 8-wide SIMD of these, and it turns out the latencies get worse, so you need 8 streams of 8-wide SIMD. Like, you can totally do that. We have
64 Huffmans.
Yeah,
or something
you would
like
have 64 Huffmans, and that's a lot of overhead to plonk down on a single stream.
Yes,
but you could totally do that.
I see.
So there's a lot of air left in that kind of thing, but it's just having to have these streams to begin with just means you have to invest upfront, and like having these extra streams means you need to signal more stuff in the encoder. At the very least, you need to make sure, like, each of these streams needs to be tested. If you take arbitrary data from the network or from disk, you need to check that there's no buffer overflows, whatever. That all needs to be safe. That validation is per stream. So having more streams means you do more of that work. It means that you have more overhead, since you need to denote in the stream, like, here's the data for stream zero, here's the data for stream one.
Right.
Like, all that stuff gets worse.
So you do have to make sure that this is actually what you want, and that the code speed is worth
it. And that also means that, like, you would rather, like, this kind of scalar thing, if you do it, where you have actual separate streams, you can do something with that on every CPU, even if they don't have good SIMD. If they can run multiple instructions at the same time, having more work you can do in the same unit interval will help you on any CPU that can execute instructions and can start executing instructions faster than it can complete them.
Because, which is most that you would target.
Stuff like memory operations, for example, like this load here. Like, pretty much every major CPU can start a new load operation every single clock cycle, but they take multiple clock cycles to complete.
Yes.
Which means these dependency chains are multiple cycles long, and there's just gaps in there, even if it's not a CPU that does multiple instructions at once. If the CPU could do multiple instructions at once, of course, it's even worse.
Right.
Because not only do you have this gap, during this gap, like you could do three instructions
right,
instead,
yes,
of one.
Instead of one.
So you have a lot more waste. So you can do these kind of
and
things.
And this is less about compression itself, yeah. but just how tweaked modern ones are.
So unfortunately, right. we are out of time.
Yes. Yeah.
That is all fantastic.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you guys so much for being here. That was at least very
pretty
educational
rad.
For me, hopefully for everyone else as well. Thank you so much for coming.